getting the response I want out of the system, okay? And it's good for making data that can be graphed. You can graph stuff in Aspen, as you've probably seen, but it's not the best. It's very, very difficult to just copy and paste stuff into Excel or whatever else you'd like to do. So we'll do both of those things, and we'll find both of the same system. All right, so I'll come up with a system here that's going to be a nice candidate for both of these tools, and you'll get a nice little introduction to both of them as we slowly go through it. All right, we're not spending our time today working on fancy chemicals or reactions or whatever else. So this will be pretty boring from that perspective. But the system itself is maybe kind of interesting. Okay, so what you're looking at here is, in some kind of Aspen-ish type of icon display, is a process flow diagram. And this is the actual one that we're trying to represent. Okay, so what's going on? There's a loop here. You can see stream one going into a pump, and then it provides a pump stream out at number two. And what we're doing here, according to the original description, is there's a chemical reactor and it's super hot. Okay, and the steam coming off the top of that is just, it's just water that's evaporated. And it's basically cooling down, whatever you're using to cool off the liquid sodium reactor or whatever, and then fed back to the other, pressurization steps of the steam cycle. So that's what we're doing. And I mentioned this a little bit in the first lecture, but because you got a loop there, some interesting things result with that when you're putting it into Aspen. It also could create some problems for you if you don't know a whole lot about the system. And so sometimes people panic when they see a loop, okay? However, there's a technique that you can use in order to panic less. Okay, so let me show you this next version that you might think about doing Aspen to start with. And just so you know, I would not do this, okay? And the reason for that is that I'm less afraid of the loops than other people are. Okay? However, there's very seasoned Aspen experts in our department that would do it this way, and they have a reason. Okay? So not to look down on anyone, but breaking the loop, okay? See what's going on there with stream one being broken into what? Stream one and stream 1B. The idea here is that means it's no longer a loop, right? And I happen to know a great deal about stream one, so it's a good place to naturally start. So it's a good stream to come out of nowhere and give myself some place to specify. And then what I hope happens is that stream 1B is identical. Okay, and I can investigate the two and tell yes or no that's the case, right? And if they turn out to be identical, I might do something like delete stream 1B and then reconnect stream 1 over to the condenser, okay? And then again, it should be fine, okay? So when loops fail, it's for two reasons, usually. One would be I forgot to put information into any of the streams, or I put information that was bad into one of the streams in a bad place where it couldn't start calculations and work its way around the circle, okay? So when that happens, of course, then you run into a wall and you get frustrated, right? And your system's in a bad place. And it can be just bad information, bad initial guesses, that kind of stuff, and it's frustrating. Okay, so if you're not used to that, you like to work. So this is not a bad idea, and it's what we're going to do today. All right, but again, not 100% required. Hopefully you can take that from what I'm saying at this point. Now, I'm going to do something else as well, because you notice that I'm not doing anything with the chemical reactor effluent other than caring about how much heat it's giving me. Okay, so somewhere along the line, I've either estimated or calculated that in order to cool this gas off from 420 to 160 or whatever it was, I need to extract 200 megawatts from it. Okay, so I have a heat stream, that's what we're trying to see with that wiggly line, that I have 200 megawatts of heat available, and that heat will go into my water and boil it and produce something exactly 360 C, ready to be expanded and have work extracted. Okay. So when you look at this diagram here, it looks fantastic, but what do you feel like might be missing from this description? We've obviously simplified the reactor stuff, right, just really looking through, but looking at what's left, which is the water steam loop, is anything bothering you about that? Other than the unknown in the middle, we'll figure that out. What else? Is anything bothering you? You're just going to generally bother, right? Abstract.
I mean, you're missing a bunch of work streams in and out.
We could label those, okay? I'll tell you that they are optional in Aspen, so we will put some in, but they're not required. Anything else bother? I mean, I can understand that bother. Because you're used to drawing them. Anybody? Nobody bothered, really? What about flow rate? Oh, yeah. So what that means is we don't know how much water is moving, okay? And we kind of need to figure that out, because let's say you got just a few drips of water going into this thing and then throwing in 200 megawatts. It will happily calculate a steam temperature of the surface of the sun. Okay. So what that means is that I need to figure that out. I need a tool to make sure that I can do that. But there should be some perfect water flow that is in the heat exchanger that when it picks up 200 megawatts, results in a perfectly conditioned stream coming out of 360. Okay? So, and whatever pressure, I told it was 20.5 bar. Okay? You guys can understand that idea there? So there's a little bit of info that it's going to need, but it's being like intentionally withheld right now. So you're going to have to make a guess at what the flow is and see what happens to start. You have to. Otherwise, it won't start. Right? You won't get any support. All right? So that's the idea. And because I don't know what that is and it's super important, I'm going to kind of stop after just the heat exchanger before I start adding in all this other stuff after the fact. Because if I can't get that right, then it doesn't need to be frustrated with the rest of the stuff. Okay, so I'm going to put in streams 1, 2, and 3 and the first two blocks and start there. Everybody understand the idea there? Okay, so that's the strategy. Go back to Aspen. I'm going to make a brand new simulation. And it usually, but it will default for me to the METC bar unit set, which is fine. I have this problem kind of specified as you saw with bar, pressure, and Celsius behaviors. So that's just fine. Okay, I'm not worried about that. As usual, it takes me to this first screen, which says, okay, what chemicals are you interested in? Anybody want to tell me what chemicals I'm interested in? Water. And that's it, right? Nothing else. And water happens to be one of those ones that's a rather common chemical. So I can just type in the word, and it gives me water. H2O, sure enough. Okay, so we touched out so far. And that's the only thing that I need, so nothing fancy compared to what we've done with some of the other examples up to this point. I can move on to the next thing that's required. That what you can do is the next red circle you saw in the list over here. And yeah, I need to make a thermodynamic method to select. Okay, this is water. What do you guys usually use with water?
Steam tables.
So you can use NISC online, or maybe you got a book with some of them in there. Those are probably the ones you find first are probably the 1967 steam tables, which is what you see selected here as the free water method. What I'm going to do is switch all of those to the NDS because I like that one more. Okay, so we use steam NDS for all of the options here, and these are of course National Bureau standards, just up the road in Boulder. And I'm going to also choose that for my method. Now it's listed as one of the common methods, okay, but if you wanted to, you could come over here and filter it to like water, right? Water and steam. So cut that down a little bit. I'm not going to bother because I'm looking for steam NDS. Okay, so it shows up in both places. All right, and I've done the usual two things that's required to get moving in acid, at least in this properties environment. I've got the chemicals, chemical or chemicals selected. I've got whatever thermo method I'd like to use, and then if required, some separate water calculation method for steam or liquid water or ice or whatever. So I'm using that for both, it's fine. Okay, everything that I get out of this is going to come from some kind of steam table lookup. All right, and as you can see, everything, when you collapse these, you can see a little better. Blue check marks everywhere, I don't see any half-filled circles, they should be good. And it says go ahead and run the analysis. You can do this first without leaving the environment if you want to. By the way, it looks like it's running much better than the last time we were together, which I should not have said that just now because it was listening, but we'll see if we can hang in there. Table generation complete. This is what you're looking for to make sure everything worked out. Okay. And yeah, sometimes there's an intermediate step between these that requires you to look at interaction parameters, but you don't have to change them. Water, no problem. There's only one chemical anyway, so there's no interaction to consider between it and another chemical. Okay. Does everybody follow me so far? Great. All right. And that's it. I don't want to do anything else like, you know, figure out bubble points or whatever in here with some binary analysis. I didn't, can't with only one chemical. But I'm ready to go. So I just hit, I can hit next again. All right. It says, okay, you're ready. Let's go to the simulation environment now and start building that system. Okay, I'm kind of done here, but it's ready to go. And everything I do in simulation requires me to be ready to go here in properties first. Okay. So you got to do this first. Now I can jump into simulation if I want to. And I do want to. Okay. Empty sheet. The only apparent half-filled circle is the fact that the flow sheet was not ready to go. That's because I have not fulfilled my minimum of one required block with any required screens. Okay? You can just build them with like a pump and do stuff. We will do stuff with a pump, but also in this case, add on a heat exchanger. Okay? So as I mentioned, I want to take that hot water stream, put it through the pump, I want to boost its pressure. Okay? If you want something that is a heat exchanger, you know, something that heats up, could be functioning as a cooler, of course, right? Its only job is to take a stream and change its temperature, or maybe its pressure too at the same time. Right? You can do a couple things. So I'll do, and now those arrows will show up when I start putting in material streams. And by the way, I'm almost ready to do that right now. Okay. But just remember, even though they call it a heater block, it could be a cooler too. Okay. You're going to tell it what to do, and it'll function that way. Whatever it calls itself is not important. All right, I'm going to go back over here to the little arrow key. Right. I'm not going to keep dropping any more keys. I'm going to change the name to the blocks. Okay, just kind of good practice. This pump, I'm going to call that pump. All right, I'm going to move the name out of the way. Okay, this is going to be my heat exchanger. I'm going to call it, or you know, heater. I'll just call it heat. No, let's not do that. Call it heater. Okay, because I might have. And now when I look at the list of blocks, it's got those names associated with them. And I'm going to see the red required connections and the blue optional ones. And I'll just start off with the stream that comes out of nowhere for the moment, which is the feed to the pump. So I hover over the connection, click, and draw back. And there's stream one. Okay, it's already numbered correctly. Fantastic. Now I'm going to connect these next two. The pump's output will connect to the heater's input. And of course, it's never going to line up right. Okay, you can care about that, which a lot of people do. You select the stream, go back to your arrow, select the stream, right click, and say align blocks. And what it does is basically move the block.
Oh no, shit.
And everything's going to be okay, even if it doesn't look good. Right? I swear, when I was a senior, I spent years making myself look good for no reason at all. Yeah, go ahead.
What?
Your arrow will show up. So you got to make sure the material is active. I'm going back to that now. Target never breaks down. Just keep messing with it. It'll work. Don't pay attention. All right, so I got one more required thing. That's the third final stream, which is the, I guess, the exit from the heater. This is the stream that I hope is going to be 360 when all is said and done. Okay, so I'll click that and move it out. There's stream three. Yes, this looks terrible. I understand. Right, we'll make it look even more terrible soon. But I've got all the connectivity set up that I want. I've got all the blocks I want. They're named the way I want. I've got streams numbered the way I want. Okay. Now, am I kind of ready to go at this point? Well, maybe. Okay. It says here now the flow sheet's fine, but streams and blocks are not. Okay. We've got two jobs now. The first job is to say what are the streams, what of the streams need information. Not all of them will. And the blocks need to tell, you need to tell the blocks what the job is, what's the task here. Okay, so if you open up these, you can see a little bit more detail. Looking at streams, I'm required to put information into stream one, but not to increase. It's that old thing I told you about last time. When a stream comes out of nowhere, information is required. If a stream comes out of a block, Aspen assumes the block is going to do the job in the future to fill in the input. Okay? And this is another problem when you have it, because it looks, we'll tackle that at some future time. All right, but anyway, stream one, if I can get some info there, great. Okay? Take a look at the description again. Well, only things that I know are its temperature and pressure, but those are some pretty important things, as you know. Right? Those are two good state variables. Maybe you've even done a Gibbs phase rule analysis at this point and decided that's all you need. It's not quite true, okay? But you also know that it's water. It's pure water. So that's also floating out. So when you specify a stream, okay, and here's a general rule because of that, okay, you won't be able to end the composition over here, okay? And it's easy because there's only one chemical in the whole simulation, which is water. So we're going to guess, okay? Right now it's got mole flow in kilomoles per hour, and I have no idea what this is, okay? Well, I do because I've done this a number of times, but you can imagine yourself being in that situation. So you're going to just make a random guess of 14,000, okay? That's probably a good guess, all right? And if this is enough, or just the right number, unlikely, you'll get exactly 360 cc steam out of this exchanger and you're all finished. Okay?